If there is anyone who cannot see the slides, can he raise his hand? Okay, so everything is okay. So good morning, everyone. And give me a minute. I'm very excited. I'm very happy to see you all. I miss to see all the friends and all the colleagues and to go to work. And I'm very excited. And thank you for coming and listening to my PhD talk. And so today I'm going to show you the work that I did on the Dead Sea sediment. I worked on paleomagnetic research and the magnetic properties on the Dead Sea sediments. And I worked also on the environmental applications. And the two great people that introduced me, Ron and Moti, are my advisors. And so let's start. So first, I would like again to thank along the path, the long path of the PhD journey, I met wonderful people. And thank you for everyone and whoever I forgot and is not listed here, I'm very sorry. Probably slip out of my head, but I met great people and a lot of people helped me. I wouldn't do it by myself, especially thanks to my two advisors, Moti and Ron. And I'm gonna start now with a short introduction on our Earth magnetic field. So our planet has a magnetic field and we call it a geomagnetic field. And if you take an average of a few thousands of years, the best model to describe it is the geocentric axial dipole, the GAD, which means that we have a magnetic dipole along the rotational axis of the magnetic field. This field can be described by two angles everywhere on the planet. We have the inclination, which is the angle from the horizontal plane. Basically, I call it the dip of the magnetic Earth. And we have the declination, which is the angle between the geographic and the magnetic north on the horizontal plane. If we're gonna calculate the distribution of the inclination on every place on the Earth, according to the GAD model, we will get straight lines with zero values in the equators and plus 90 and minus 90 inclination in the poles. But as every model is, we have a deviation from the GAD model. We have larger deviations that are over longer time periods. And you probably heard about reversals when the polarity of the magnetic field flips to the other side. And we have also excursions that is less familiar, but it's when the magnetic field starts changing towards changing its polarity, but then it goes back again to the original polarity. We also have smaller deviation over short term. And this is what we call secular variation. In this video, you can see changes in the declination and the inclination over the last 3,000 years. And you can see that the inclination, if we compare it to the previous, it's not a straight line. And we have the zero is not, the green is the zero, is not always on the equator. So we have secular variations from the GAD model. And most people that work in the paleomagnetic world trying to get as much information about these changes. And we usually look for a high resolution archive for this geomagnetic field behavior. It helps us to improve our understanding on the behavior of the Earth outer core. It also helps us to model better geomagnetic field. And some of us use it to date our geomagnetic samples. So how do we learn about changes in the ancient geomagnetic field? We have ferromagnetic minerals. Ferromagnetic minerals can record the magnetic fields over millions of years. And here we have examples of two same images of ferromagnetic minerals. We have greggite and we have magnetite. Ferromagnetic minerals can be found in rocks, in sediment, soil, dust, and also in archaeological materials. In my work, I will be focusing on sediments. And as Moti and Ron said, I started working on the Dead Sea sediment. The reason that we choose the Dead Sea sediment, it's because it's a hypersaline lake, which means we have bioturbation that can disturb the recording of the magnetic field in the sediment. It has also a high depositional rate of 0.2 millimeter per year. And basically it can provide us the high resolution archive for the geomagnetic field. In 2010, there was the ICDP project in the Dead Sea and managed to get a long core that covers the last 220,000 years. It provides us options to study four formations, Amora, Samra, Lisan above it, and Tselim, which covers two glacial periods in three interglacial periods. In addition to the ICDP core, we can also go and study freshly exposed Holocene sediments. And on the margins, we have the Lisan formation that we collect material also. So how a sediment record the magnetic field? There are two mechanisms to record the magnetic fields. The first one is the detrital remanent magnetization, the DRM. It's when we have the detrital ferromagnetic minerals settling down in the sediment. And again, you see this tiny little one. We don't have it in the Dead Sea, and this is good for us. And when it gets to the sediment, the ferromagnetic minerals aligned along the Earth magnetic field. We consider this the DRM to be a primary magnetization. The second mechanism that we have is a chemical remanent magnetization, CRM. It's when we have chemical alteration or precipitation of ferromagnetic minerals in the sediment. This is our sediment with the original DRM. And if it's in the time, the same time that we acquire the DRM in the sediment, we have precipitation of ferromagnetic minerals, they will align to the same Earth magnetic field as the DRM. This is will be called the primary magnetization. But CRM, we can precipitate ferromagnetic minerals. It can be several years after, it can be millions of years after, and this is causes a secondary magnetization. And it's important to know what we have, if it's primary or secondary magnetization, because we can only use primary magnetization for paleomagnetic study. In the Dead Sea, we have two ferromagnetic minerals. We have titanomagnetite that is transported to the lake by aeolian dust or floods. And this is what I just said, that it's a DRM. And we have greggite, that it's iron sulfur mineral and it's microbially mediated. And this is a typical CRM mineral. Here in this electron microscopy image of one from one of my samples, you can see have a titanomagnetite that carries primary magnetization, and around it we have a rim of greggite. If it's primary or secondary magnetization, I will answer further on in the talk. So how do we reveal the magnetic paleomagnetic directions? First, we collect oriented samples in plastic box. The box needs to be non-magnetic. Then we take it to our lab and measure it. This is the shielded room in our lab. We have two magnetometers. We measure the sample in the magnetometer, and we demagnetize the sample small increments and measure the magnetic vector after each demagnetization. To give you a clue of how it works, we plot the magnetic vector. If you remember, we can describe it with two angles, inclination and declination. The blue sign is the inclination and the red one is the declination. These diagrams plot two planes. The inclination is plotted over north and down because it's the vertical component, and the declination is plotted over north and east, the horizontal. And this is, these two marks represent the original magnetization of the sample. Then we induce the sample to a weak to a magnetic field. We demagnetize the sample and then measure it again. This is after 5 millitesla. We demagnetize again. This is after 10 millitesla. This is after 15 millitesla, and on and on. What we are looking for is to get points that converge to the origin, and when they do, we can calculate the best fit fit line. And from this, we can get our inclination and declination. In this case, we have inclination of 34.7 and declination of 353. So we do that for every sample. And now I'm going to show you the paleomagnetic results. I'm gonna start with the Lisan formation. Here we have the declination and inclination that I just explained to you how we measure it versus the age from the blue dots are from the Masada M1 outcrop, and the orange one are from the Dead Sea deep core. The reason that we have declination from the deep core is because the core was not originally oriented. Can calculate the declination. And I want you to pay attention for two things. The first one is that the data from the Dead Sea deep core is very scattered. This is not a typical circular variation behavior. We have basically the data is all over the place, from plus 80 the inclination to minus 20. Compared to Masada, that is more compact. If we take a look on this area that we have samples from image, we get different magnetic directions for the same sediment. So what do we have here? Do we see different magnetic mineralogy for the two different sections? when I continued in measuring the paleomagnetic data from Samra and Amora. Here again, we have the inclination versus depth. The lower part is samples that belongs to Amora that comes from the glacial period, and the upper part is belong to the Samra formation from interglacial period. Again, you can see that the data from Samra is much more scattered compared to Amora. If we look on the angular uncertainty, most of the samples from Samra have angular uncertainty that is much smaller, most of them below 5 degrees. And if we look on the magnetization of the samples, this Samra has a much stronger magnetization than Amora. And do we see different magnetic properties for different climb periods? In the last two slides of my first paleomagnetic data shows the important to have a rock magnetic investigation and to see if we have any environmental influences on the magnetic mineralogy. And this is led me to, I think, the biggest project that I did in my PhD is to try to answer these three questions for most of my settings. What is the mechanism controlling the magnetic recording? Can we recover an accurate paleomagnetic direction from the Dead Sea sediments? And how environmental conditions affect the magnetic properties? I'm going to start answering the first two questions on two different time periods. I'm going to start on the Lissan and on the Holocene. And I'm going to start first from the Lissan. So when I magnetically extracted the sediments from the Lissan formation, these samples were taken from the ICDP core. The electron microscopy images here shows the dissolution of titanomagnetite. Here we have a little bit of the dissolution of titanomagnetite with pyrite rim around it. And in this case, the titanomagnetite was heavily dissolved. There is only small parts of titanomagnetite left. The rest are veins of pyrite entering. And I also found iron sulfur mineralogy with different composition. The area of one had a composition that it's closer to pyrite, and pyrite is a paramagnetic mineral. It's non-magnetic. And in the area of two, I got a composition of greigite, which is a ferromagnetic mineral. And the questions that I was asking it, can what we just see, these weird creatures, can affect the magnetization that we saw in the Lissan? To answer that, I went to work in Simon Emanuel's lab. I used the atomic force microscopy with magnetic tip. It's magnetic force microscopy, MFM. And the MFM produces a nanometric scale map of the relative magnetic field intensity of the sample, which means that if we have our sample, and this is our magnetic tip, when it passes above the sample, when it feels attraction, it will produce a black pattern, and when it feels rejection, we will get a white pattern. And when there is no magnetic field, we should get a natural color. I start first scanning with the MFM, the iron sulfur mineralogy. In here, in this case, we have an image of a pyrite rhomboid. Now, pyrite is a paramagnetic mineral, therefore I should get all natural color, but when we scan it, I found inclusions of black and white pairs. These inclusions, you can see them here in a larger view, are greigite inclusions, and basically make this paramagnetic mineral into a very strong ferromagnetic minerals. And greigite can be a secondary magnetization, and this explains the scattered data that we saw in the Lisan from the ICDP samples. From here, I continue on scanning the titanomagnetite. I wanted to see what happens to the titanomagnetite while it's being dissolved. I started first scanning undissolved titanomagnetite. Here we have a topographic map from the AFM of our grain. This is a titanomagnetite. And here is the MFM scanning. You can see this is a typical patterns of black and white of this size of a ferromagnetic mineral. And when I start scanning a partially dissolved titanomagnetite, like in this one here with the pyrite around it, you can see here that the pyrite give us the natural color. And here we see the black and white patterns of titanomagnetite. Here you can see the veins of the pyrite starting to divide the titanomagnetite to smaller areas. I think you can see it better here when we have a grain that is heavily dissolved. You can see that all that we have left from the titanomagnetite is small islands around the paramagnetic pyrite. This dissolution of the primary titanomagnetite causes secondary magnetization, and the reason is we are physically changing the magnetic domains of the grains, the magnetic patterns that we see here, and this is a new mechanism for secondary magnetization. This mechanism is very important for people who works in paleomagnetic on sediments. And we got a focus paper on our work that says that it's fundamental, our study fundamental aspects of remnants acquisition in the sediments. So if we summarize that, what we learned about the magnetic properties of the Lisan formation, the MFM data reveals evidence of secondary magnetization. The secondary magnetization that we saw explains the scattered paleomagnetic data and explains the difference between the Masada and the ICDP core. And if you remember, I said that we cannot use secondary magnetization for paleomagnetic studies. So therefore, the Lisan formation cannot be used for secular variation studies. So we answered the first two questions about the Lisan. And I'm going to focus now on these two questions on the Holocene. I chose to work on the Holocene, on the freshly exposed sediments that we have in the recent years. This is a beautiful pictures from Enfeshcha. The reason that I worked on the freshly exposed, it's like basically it's easier. I can also get the declination and I can get as much material as I want. Sample the three outcrops. Og, the northern part close to the Jordan River, and Feshcha, 5 kilometers south of there, and Engedi, which is 40 kilometers south of there. All the three outcrops represent more or less the same time periods. In the next few slides, you're gonna see my plots, the diagrams, and you're gonna see height instead of depth. The reason is because I started sampling my outcrops from a very famous beach ridge, unconformity that we have in the sediment that occurred around 3,000 years ago in the Dead Sea. So you're gonna see height instead of depth. I'm gonna use in the next, I think most of the talk from now, magnetic terms, magnetic susceptibility. It's a commonly used for stratigraphic correlation, and it's I use it here for magnetic mineralogy investigation. What is it? Magnetic susceptibility is the response of a material. This is the magnetic susceptibility to applied field. And this is what we measure, the magnetization. The magnetic susceptibility, I want you to remember that, is controlled by the concentration and the type of the ferromagnetic mineral that we have. So any changes in the ferromagnetic minerals, in the type of the ferromagnetic minerals or concentration will affect the magnetic susceptibility. So I'm gonna start showing you the result of the magnetic susceptibility from the three outcrops from Og and Feshchein and Gedi. I think the first thing that you can see, they don't look alike. And if you remember, they represent more or less the same time period. Og has a high and uniform magnetic susceptibility, and Feshcha starts with low intermediate susceptibility and goes to high susceptibility and goes back down again. And Gedi do not have at all a high susceptibility. And it starts with intermediate, goes to low susceptibility, and then to intermediate again. And if you remember, we have two ferromagnetic minerals in our sediments. We have titanomagnet and we have greggite. And I just told you that any change in the magnetic mineralogy or the concentration can affect the magnetic susceptibility. So the question was, which one of the magnetic mineral imposed the changes that we see here in the susceptibility? I'm gonna start with Og, the northern section, with the high susceptibility values. Here we have electron microscopy images. The samples from Og and the high content of greggite. You can see all these white, bright minerals are greggite. The dominant mineral was greggite, although there is titanomagnetite. The same thing in Enfeshcha. The samples from the high susceptibility values, a high content of greggite. Again, you can see beautiful images of greggite from all of the samples. When we looked in samples from intermediate susceptibility values, we started to see a different iron sulfur mineral. We got pyrite in our samples. We got also aggregates that are mixed composition. Again, we have the darker gray is pyrite and the lighter gray is greggite. We have less greggite in the samples, the intermediates. And when we examine sediments from Engedi, all over Engedi, there were almost no sulfides. We only found a little bit of pyrite, a little bit of greggite from the areas of intermediate values. The dominant magnetic mineral in Engedi with titanium magnetite. So if we summarize the magnetic susceptibility result that we see, the content of greggite is the one who imposes the changes in the magnetic susceptibility. The more greggite that we have, the higher the susceptibility will be compared to a low susceptibility in Engedi that is being controlled by titanomagnetite. So why do we have changes in the amount of greggite? We have three outcrops from the lake with different amount of greggite in it. To answer that, we have to first understand the formation, how greggites in our sediment. To create a very basic and simple diagram of the formation of greggite in anoxic condition. A greggite precursor of pyrite, and in order to get greggite, we need sulfite and iron reducing bacteria activity. We need the sulfite reducing bacteria needs a variety of sulfate and organic matter. They produce sulfides that reacts with the reduced the reactive iron. And in order to continue and to form pyrite, and there are two ways: we can or add more sulfides, or we can get rid of the iron. So to answer why we have changes in the amount of greggite, we measure the limiting factors of the greggite formation in the pore fluids of the sediments, from the sediments. We measure the sulfate and the reactive iron. And we also measure the salinity. The reason that we measure the salinity, it's because we have the bacteria activity, which is very sensitive to changes in the salinity. The pore fluid work was done with Ilan Levy. Ilan Levy did his PhD on the pore fluids from the ICDP core, from the Dead Sea. He did it in Ben Gurion University. We extracted the pore fluids from the same sediments, from the same place that I took my paleomagnetic measurements. And the pore fluids are the trapped Dead Sea lines from the water sediment interface. So I'm going to start showing first the result of the total dissolved solids, which represent the salinity in the Dead Sea. Here we have the TDS over height. The red dots are from Enfeshcha, the green ones are from Og, and the blue ones are from Engedi. We can see here that more or less we have a uniform salinity except from one sample from Engedi. And the average salinity that we get is similar to the Holocene pore fluids that were extracted from the deep core. We see no post-exposure evaporation. We don't see also evidence for mixing with fresh groundwater. When we looked on the reactive iron in our pore fluid samples, again, the red ones are from Enfeshcha, the green ones Og, and Engedi are the blue. All the outcrops had access of reactive iron as a result of the microbial iron reduction in the sediments. So we see that the reactive iron is not a limiting factor. When we measure sulfite, again, we have access of sulfate. And since we have access of sulfate, it implies on incomplete microbial sulfate reductions. So if we go back again to our diagram, we have sulfate, We have reactive iron. So why this one doesn't produce more? It doesn't reduce the sulfate. We think it's due to a lack of organic matter. We think that the availability of organic matter limits the microbial activity in the sediment. There's a significant organic matter source in the sea is the Donalea algae, and it blooms at fresh surface water lake. We need a fresh water supply to the Dead Sea. This enables the bloom of the Donalea, and this promotes the microbial sulfate reduction activity. So we see that the location of the outcrops is important for changes in the ergite to be more precise, we need fresh water supply. We need the algae to bloom, and we need organic matter. And the question is, do we see any connection between the greigite content and the location relatively to the Jordan River, which is the main fresh water supply to the lake? So if we look here on these three diagrams, we have in black the susceptibility, in red is the reactive iron versus the height of the sections. This is Og, beneath it is in Feshchain, and this is in Gedi. I think the most impressive thing here to see that when we get a uniform susceptibility, we also get a uniform concentration of reactive iron. When we see changes in the susceptibility, we get changes in reactive iron, also in Enfeshcha and also in Engedi. I think it's it tells us basically that the susceptibility is controlled by the microbial activity. Now, if we're gonna look relatively to the location, if we check the location of the two outcrops with the high susceptibility, the high content of greigite, they are closer to the Jordan River, they are closer to the fresh air input compared to Engedi that had barely had the greigite, and it's the farthest outcrop from the Jordan River. So we think that the more greigite that we have, the higher the susceptibility is, and the outcrop is closer to the Jordan River. Now, I chose the best sections that we have, which is the Enfeshcha, and I looked over the time, the changes in the susceptibility, and compared it to the Dead Sea lake level. This is the running average of the susceptibility from Enfeshcha, and this is Dead Sea lake level that it's a composition that I make from three different studies. And you can see that we have the higher susceptibility when we have a higher lake level. And I think that the susceptibility can be indicative when we have a higher level, a lake level. So if we summarize the Holocene rock magnetic investigation and the environmental implications, we see that the sulfate reduction controls the content in the sediment. Since the microbial activity is limited by organic matter availability, and it depends on the fresh water supply, I think we can use susceptibility as a proxy for changes in the fresh water influx to the Dead Sea. So I answered the two questions to the Holocene, and now can we use the Holocene for magnetic directions? We just saw that Cadent magnetic mineral holocene is greigite. And I explained to you at the beginning that greigite is a chemical remanent magnetization, and it can be primary and it can be also secondary. I think it's a primary magnetization. The reason that I think it's a primary magnetization is because we found in the pore fluid axis of a reactive iron and sulfate. It means that the production, the precipitation of greigite in the sediment stops the minute that we run out of organic matter. It stops, and therefore the greigite carry a primary magnetization. And yes, we can use the holocene sediment for paleomagnetically. Just to remind you quickly, I sampled 5 samples from each horizon in the holocene to reduce the uncertainties. And I'm going to show you now the paleomagnetic result from Enfeshka. The reason that I took Enfeshka is again because it's the longest outcrop. It gives us the longest time. Here we have the tension and inclination versus the height. Each of these is an average of 5 samples. In addition to magnetic data, we calculated the age using a Bayesian model for 10 radiocarbon samples. And when we calculate the age, this is the inclination and declination versus the age. We got, I think it's a beautiful secular variation from 2750 cal year BP to 1150 cal year BP. And when we compare it to archaeomagnetic samples, we collected from many places around Israel, we can see that there is a good correlation with our archaeomagnetic samples. And I think we can say that we have a high resolution secular version of 1500 years from the Holocene. So the final conclusions of this talk today is that the microbial activity influenced the magnetic mineralogy in the Dead Sea sediment. It can be by precipitating greigite as primary magnetization, as we saw in the Holocene, and it can be by the dissolution of titanomagnetite in the Lisan formation, which causes a secondary magnetization. We can't use the Lisan formation secular variation reconstruction. But on the other hand, the Holocene sediment provide a high resolution star variation data. We also saw that the magnetic properties of late Holocene are controlled by the content of greigite and can be used as a proxy for changes in the Jordan River flux. And I would like to thank you.
And I would like to thank Chagai Ron that always believed in me and insist on me continuing and coming to do a PhD with him. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Okay, Yael, thank you very much.
שתביא לי סופר אמר.
יקי, תזכיר שם את כולם חוץ מאת עצמך.
יקי, I cannot. Tell me.
תשקיט את כולם חוץ מעצמך.
יעקב, I'm gonna mute all and then you let whoever you want, whoever wants to talk, unmute yourself.
אוקיי.
זה מרכב של הסמינריון.
I just muted everyone and whoever wants to talk and Yaki gives you the right to talk, just unmute yourself.
Okay, Yael, thank you very much. It was really nice to see you at your first stages of your PhD. I enjoyed it as a friend of you that knows you for very long. And now we are going to allow a few questions. So who has a question?
It looks like Yoni Israeli raised his hand, no?
I don't see who is raising a hand. By the way, we had 80 people, 80 participants.
Whoever wants to ask a question, unmute and ask.
Exactly. Questions. So I have a question. I saw those same images or high resolution same image of the titanomagnetite and greggite. And yeah. The greggite looks like a corona or something around the titanomagnetite, or it's coming as inclusions inside the titanomagnetite. What do you know about, so it seems like a secondary development, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
What can you say about the formation of the greggite from the titanium magnetite and how it basically influenced the magnetic record of the two minerals, the titanium magnetite and the greggite? I hope I'm clear enough.
Are you talking about this image? You are not so clear. Or are you talking about here?
You showed two images. This is one, and the other one is the greggite looks like inclusions inside the titanomagnetite. So how it forms? What's the mechanism?
You're talking about this one? This one is inclusion inside pyrite, not inside titanomagnetite.
Oh, inside pyrite, okay. I'm sorry.
The pyrite.
Okay.
Basically, what you see here, greggite, as I said, is a precursor of pyrite. And I think the MFM here, the MFM scan shows beautifully that it's a precursor of pyrite. Usually, the greggite turns completely to pyrite. But in the case of this pyrite rhomboid, it stayed in. For many years, a lot of paleomagnetists pay attention that when you are magnetically extracted, when you go with a magnet over a sediment, sometimes you get pyrite in. No one understood why the pyrite attracts some of the pyrite attracts to the magnet and some of them are not. I think this image shows you that in some cases you still have a remnant of the precursor greggite inside the pyrite.
Okay, any other questions?
Yes, I will ask a question. Yael, maybe you can elaborate for the people a little bit about the use of magnetic susceptibility. What actually came in you out of your study to tell the people, the magnetic community, about the use of, also the people who are using the susceptibility in sedimentology. What is actually the implication for them?
The application of magnetic susceptibility, you can say two things. The first one is, I think you should always be cautious and careful when you use magnetic susceptibility, because as I said, it can be influenced by the concentration and the type of ferromagnetic mineral. But at the moment, the minute that you understand what control your magnetic mineral, I think you, as you see here, it's a very simple and cheap measurement. And if in the case of the Dead Sea, it gives you, it tells you, let's say, when you have changes in the freshwater input, you can use it to reconstruct changes in the freshwater input to the Dead Sea.
So actually, what you say is that that people are using the magnetic susceptibility for correlation between different sections. They should be very careful about it.
Yes, I just demonstrate you that we have three outcrops from the same lake with different magnetic susceptibility for the same age of sediment.
Well, I have a question.
Okay, I have two.
Okay.
Yes, two questions.
About the correlation between the magnetic susceptibility and the freshwater input, would that be applicable to any lake or any saline lake, or what other information you would need to know about a specific lake system to be able to use this correlation?
I think that any depositional environment is unique. I think that wherever you go to work, let's say, you know, if you go to a different saline lake, so you will say, okay, it should be similar to the Dead Sea, but again, each deposition environment in it's different, and I would do all the rock magnetic investigations in any place, in every place that you go. If you go look on all the diagenesis processes that you see in sediments, lots of people see, you know, the work of Gilad Antler. He showed you that in a distance of 200 meters, you have a different diagenetic process. And as I showed you, it affects the magnetization, but it can be that you are in a lake that it doesn't. Again, it depends on magnetic mineralogy and the conditions in the sediment.
Okay, I wanted to ask another. I want to ask you, what is the ratio of, or maybe you don't know it, but what is the ratio between greigite and pyrite from when you go from north to south, let's say from Og down to...
How much do I have in the sediment?
Yeah, the ratio between those, because you said you have more greigite as you go north, but maybe it is because it is more preserved. It is not that susceptible to recrystallization, to form pyrite, you see? Or formed more greigite than pyrite.
I don't know the ratio, but what you can see here, wait, Boaz, can you see? Wait, sorry, you are this, yeah. I have to move you first.
No, I see,
You can see how much sulfate that you have in Engedi. I think the reason that you also have more sulfate in the pore fluids in Engedi is because you have less microbial reduction.
Okay. Yeah, maybe. It's pretty low anyway, if you compare it, let's say. Mm-hmm. You can put, let's say, the sulfate in the Dead Sea.
But then, Boaz, if you compare, you have here 10 millimol per, and here you have 5 millimol per.
Five.
So,
yeah.
So then the northern sections.
This could be, if you're right, then we should see. Okay, you didn't do it, or Ilan didn't do the isotopes, no?
No, we wanted to do, but you can't do it all. Sometimes you have to know where to stop to finish your PhD. But what I can show you, I have magnetic measurements that shows you that there is no greigite in Engedi
okay.
compared to Ogen and Feshcha.
Yeah, but so, it didn't answer whether preserved or it wasn't there from the beginning. That's the question. That's actually the first question. Because then it says something about, if it, maybe it has something to do also with the source, as you said, from the north to south, but it is the real primary precipitation of greigite or preservation. All of it had greigite, but somehow it is more preserved in the north than in the south.
Okay, but then I have a question for you. Why it won't preserved in the south?
I don't know. No, I'm asking you if, so you if need this to, is a possibility.
In order to not preserve it, I think you need, I don't know, I think you need to oxidize the sediment. And if you would have oxidized the sediment, you wouldn't have reactive iron in the pore fluids.
Anyway, I think you have to see is how much total iron you have in the sediments from north to south. If it is the same, maybe it's
total iron, but preservation. Also the total iron will give you the clays that you have
You're right.
Okay.
Anyway, Pyro.
Okay. Another question. Last question. Yael, can you go to the diagram where you show the Amora and the Samra formation? And can you comment what is the implication of your study for these findings? What is the next step according to your findings?
The next step of what?
According to the conclusion of what you were doing now, what can you do with the Amora and the Samra formation?
What will I do with Samra and Amora?
What can you do? What can you do?
I didn't. I need to do a rock magnetic work on it. I can't tell you further than that. I can tell you that it looks like that Amora, dominant magnetic mineral should be titanomagnetite, the way that it looks like. The magnetization and the larger uncertainty is more typical of titanomagnetite, where since Samra is being controlled by changes in the amount of greigite, but it can. I didn't do any rock magnetic investigation on it yet.
Okay, thank you. I just want to say we scheduled another seminar of Yoav Ben-Dor, but if there is another question that is not for Moti, we'll allow it and then we go on to the other seminar. It was my mistake to schedule it so close. I'm sorry, but this is what we have now. Any other question, if there is? Any other question? Second time. Okay. Third time. Yael, thank you very much. Okay. We enjoyed it very much.